إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أرسله بالحق بشيرا ونذيرا بين يدي الساعة من يطع الله ورسوله فقد رشد ومن يعص الله ورسوله فلا يضر إلا نفسه ولا يضر الله شيئا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا أما بعد It is the sunnah of Allah that when He created humans, He created them and described them as well as sinners. Because had Allah created us without sins, He wouldn't have created us. He would have created angels. He would have made us as angels. So it's a normal thing for human beings to make mistakes. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had himself said, Wallahi, if you don't sin, Allah will bring, replace you with people better than you who will sin and then repent to Allah. So, committing a sin in itself is not abnormal. The problem comes when you're persistent on the sin. The problem comes also when the shaitan invests in that sin. Persistent, how you kill it? You repent to Allah, and alhamdulillah in Islam, repentance is very easy. However you don't, then that's a problem there. The second issue is when the shaitan invests in that sin that he made you do. How so? And that's the topic I'm going to talk about. The shaitan makes one sin, and makes him, and sways him from the path that Allah guided him for. As we know, we human beings, especially us Muslims, were never created for how others were created or how their goals are. To watch the Super Bowl every year, see who's going to win. That's their goal for the whole year. Watch the Super Bowl. Not a problem with that. But once that becomes a goal in itself, then that's a problem. Their goal is to live for the weekend and get drunk and do whatever they want to do on the weekend. Their goal is a retirement in so-and-so state, and that's about it. Get married, have kids, which is all nothing wrong with that. But once that becomes a goal, there's a problem with that. The shaitan sways you and makes you think that's your goal. Your goal as a Muslim is something totally different. Allah in the Quran said, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ I created human and jinn for one reason, to worship me. Worship me doesn't mean to come in Jum'ah 24 hours a day, 24/7. You may be working out. That could be ibadah, depending on your intention. You may be spending time with your wife. That is a path for you to heaven as well. And you get ajr for it. So it has a broad meaning, meaning you follow the commands of Islam. You as a Muslim have to know that you were created for a goal. Not just to waste your life. You were created for that. So the shaitan comes to you and says, oh, you did this and this sin. You're not good for Islam. Just forget about Islam in totality. Forget about da'wah for Allah. That's when you... I'm not going to talk about the sins itself. That's a totally different topic and how you repent. But don't let the shaitan invest in you and make you and sway you away from da'wah to Allah, from being a proud Muslim who shouts and tells the world, I'm a Muslim. You got to sit and think every night before you go to bed. I'm a Muslim. I'm a Muslim. What percentage of my thought goes to the Muslims around the world? Their sorrows, their happiness, their problems, the things that go around through the world. What percentage of my thought? Every one of us has problems. What percentage of that goes to the Muslims? You're a Muslim? Percentage of that has to go to the Muslims. What percentage of your work goes to Islam? We work 40 hours a week. How much does that go to Islam? You owe a zakah on that. You know, not only is there zakah in your wealth, you pay 2.5% according to what we know if you keep money for over a year. I mean, no. If you got knowledge, you got zakah on that. If you got energy, you got zakah on that. If you got anything that Allah given, you have to give zakah on that. What percentage of your reading is for Islam? You know, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to sit with his companion and weep over us, saying, "I miss my friends. I miss my brother." They said, "Oh Prophet of Allah, we are your brothers." He said, "No, you guys are my friends. They're his sahaba. My brothers are people who come after me and believe in me without seeing me." So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, 14 centuries ago, used to miss us. Yet we don't in return open a book, translate it into English, and read the detailed history of that man. Wallahi, the life of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam should be known to every single Muslim like the back of your hand. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, every life. How could you love the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam if you don't know about his life? If you love an actor or actress like they do, you sit and pick up every magazine, every article, you go on the internet and do a search on their name, and you try to read everything. Why? Because you love that person, you want to know more about them. How about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that you're going to join him in heaven, that you're going to need him on the judgment day to rescue you by the will of Allah from hell and unto heaven? Keep in mind, you're a Muslim. When you're a Muslim, it doesn't mean you just say, "I'm a Muslim," and go to sleep in your house. It means you convey this message. You're part of a legacy. You're part of a legacy that goes all the way back, not to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but all the way back to Adam, all the way back to Nuh, all the way back to Musa and Ibrahim, all the way back to Isa and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Those are our forefathers. Those are our ancestors. We follow in their footsteps. وَأَنَّ هَذِهِ أُمَّتُكُمْ أُمَّةٌ وَاحِدَةٌ. This whole ummah, those messengers, are all our ancestors. Look at Nuh alayhi salam. In the Quran, he weeps. Rabbi, inni da'awtu qawmi laylan wa nahar. He was a Muslim. And you know in the Quran, Allah described all those messengers as Muslim. Nuh, Rabbi, he complains to Allah. What's the problem, Nuh? Rabbi, I make da'wah to my people. How long did he make da'wah to his people? One time on campus? A few times holding a table on campus? Maybe talking to someone in the instant messenger? No. 950 years in da'wah. In the Quran, لَبِثَ فِيهِمْ أَلْفَ سَنَةٍ إِلَّا خَمْسِينَ. 1,000 years take away 50. That's what in the Quran says. That's not his life. That's his da'wah life. What did he say to Allah? رَبِّ إِنِّي دَعَوْتُ قَوْمِي night and day. I go to him, follow the right path. What happens? Oh Allah, every time I come to him, they run away. Not only do they run away, they plug their ears and they take their shirts and cover their faces with it. وَإِنِّي كُلَّمَا دَعَوْتُهُمْ لِتَغْفِرَ لَهُمْ جَعَلُوا أَصَابِعَهُمْ فِي أَذَانِهِمْ وَاسْتَخْشَوْا ثِيَابَهُمْ. اسْتَخْشَوْا ثِيَابَهُمْ means they take their clothing and cover their face. They don't want to even see me. 950 years. This is our ancestors. This is the kind of, when the devil comes to you, tells you, "Hey, you got this sin, you got that sin, you got that sin." You're not part of da'wah. You can't give da'wah. That's when you stop the devil in his footsteps. The sin is a different issue. We don't want to talk about that. Da'wah is another issue. You better go. Because if everyone who makes mistakes can't give da'wah, I wouldn't be here in front of you. I'm a human being. And as a human being, I have to make mistakes. You as a human being have to make mistakes. Everyone after the Prophet ﷺ. Then we leave Islam and da'wah side, and we say, "The heck." No, that's not the way you work. You follow the footpath of Nuh alayhi salam. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salam, he climbs a mountain. That mountain today, to go in a car needs 45 minutes. You gotta go in a circular way. And actually, there's plenty of people who die on that way. Cause it's a cliff. You just go right. Your car may tip right over, or you may lose control over your car, especially going down. He went on it on a camel. He gets up to the top and he tells them, "Please don't tell Quraysh, the people I left in Mecca, that I'm coming to convey a message." They say, "What's the message?" He said, "Worship one Allah." He wants to rescue him from hell. They throw him and beat him with stones and shoes until he leaves the town with the children and the mentally ill, throwing shoes and stones at the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to the point that his servant covers him so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam won't be harmed, until he gets to a valley near Mecca, between Taif and Mecca. One man comes out of there, embraces Islam. He thinks all that, the shoes, if one shoe fell on me, I probably leave Islam. Astaghfirullah. The shoes and stones fell on him. One guy became a Muslim after he left, and he thought it was worth it. He was happy. One guy. Jibril comes to him, he says, you want those people, Ta'if comes, if you look at it, ever go to Hajj, pay attention to a Ta'if, it's a mountain, and the people are on top of that mountain, that's where the city is, there's two huge mountains next to it. Jibril says, you want me, come, and close those two mountains on them, for what they did to you? He said, no, maybe if one of them comes, who worships Allah, that's enough. And indeed one. He thought it was worth it. That's the people that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam raised like that. You know, Tufayl ibn Amr al-Dawsi, a companion, came to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Before he came, they warned them. Quraysh warned them. They told them, watch out, that guy says stuff that is magic, may have effect on your brain, so don't talk to him. He said, okay, I'll walk around the Kaaba, and I won't listen to him. You know what he even did? He plugged his ears with cotton so he won't hear the Prophet reciting Quran by the Kaaba. Then as he's walking around the Kaaba, said, I got a brain and I know what's right from wrong. Why don't I listen to this man? He sat next to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he listened to some of the Quran, he listened to the message, and on the spot he says, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Became Muslim. The point of the story is not how he became a Muslim. The point is that's all he left with. He went back to his tribe, those that still their descendants live until today. They're in the area between Medina and Mecca till today. He went back. What do you think he did? Chill out and sleep? Rest? I'm a Muslim, that's it? He went back and told his family, I've become a Muslim. This is the message. This is the Prophet never gave him one single verse or one hadith about conveying Islam, as we later have. He went on, he brought the whole tribe back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as Muslim. And amongst that tribe is the great hero that you know of, Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, that you can't flip a page of hadith without reading his name. He went back and conveyed the message. What made him? When you're a Muslim, you can't just say you're a Muslim and kick back. You gotta give da'wah. Da'wah doesn't mean to give a lecture. That's a small way of giving da'wah. You may have a tape. You may give out a book. You may join an MSA. You may make a website. You may write an article. The paths of da'wah are open. If every single Muslim took on a path of himself for da'wah, this Islam would be the leadership of the world. That's how Islam spread to what we know, the Philippines, Malaysia, and some of those countries, spread through the merchants who went there and conveyed the da'wah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's why you can't say you're a Muslim and kick back and relax. The Sahaba who led the world within 13 years, when you ask them, the Prophet used to ask them, what's your dreams? After Fajr, he'd sit, and they would sit in a gathering. What dream did you have? And they would sit and tell him a dream. You know what all the dreams about? If you ask me what my dream is, it's about how to buy a mansion. I'm thinking about buying a mansion, and a nicer car, and a better job. The first one's how to spread Islam. The second one, how to do more for Islam. The third one, nothing materialistic. Their hopes and dreams were for Islam. When he asked them for wishes, what's your wishes? Umar radiallahu anhu sits down and asks them, what's your wishes? The first one says, I wish I had so and so amount of silver and gold to spend it for the sake of Allah. The second one says, I wish I had a room full of gold for the sake of Allah. Umar's turn comes. He says, I wish I had a room full of people like Abu Ubaidah so I can send them and spread da'wah for the sake of Allah. Imagine that. Their hopes, their dreams, their wishes, Islam, Islam. Wallahi, if you were to cut their jugular veins and it were to write something out, it would be La ilaha illallah, Muhammadun Rasulullah, Islam. That's what they lived for. Don't tell me they didn't have a life like we do. They weren't lawyers, they weren't engineers, they had jobs. They were farmers. They were businessmen. But that's not their goal in life. They had something else that was a goal in life that's going to reach them the peak of heaven, inshallah. For Islam, they were born. For Islam, they live. And for Islam, they die. أقول هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه. Alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah, amma ba'd. Again, everyone should participate in da'wah in one way or another. I say this because, mashallah, we had a Jum'ah here, and actually it's the first Jum'ah. Look at the reward of da'wah. If I were to go out and help get one person embracing Islam, every single person from his generation to the judgment day, I get reward for. Imagine that. Now, they started a Jum'ah. May Allah reward them and place barakah in them. This will continue, inshallah, for a long time. In fact, forever. Inshallah, will continue as long as the construction of this place is up. And you know what? Every single one who participated is going to get the ajr of that all the way. That's exactly what the Prophet ﷺ said. Whomever starts something good, he will get the reward of that until the judgment day. Not a tiny less there of everyone who came. The ones who started, maybe two or three sisters and a brother or so, or a few brothers. Every single one of us who come here in the next Jum'ah, in the next one. Wallahi, I know a professor, we were just talking about him before the Jum'ah. He started the first Jum'ah in MSA down in another local university. He started it in 1988. I remember because I was in high school and I used to pray Jum'ah with him. It's 15, 16 years ago. It still continues until today. Imagine that. Ajr of every single person comes to him, and it was, we used to have a Jum'ah where, wallahi, as some of the brothers here would tell you, the room wasn't big enough for the people. 15, imagine that, 16 years. That's what you get for da'wah. It's the best. You ask me what the best job is. If you go to counselor, he's going to tell you, oh, you like to work with people, do law. If you like to work with machines, you do engineer. If you like to, I tell you, you want the best job of all jobs? Listen to what Allah says. Allah says, and look how unique it is. Who is better? If you tell me, right? You know I'm older. Or are some of the professors who are with us. They tell you, who's better than one who does this? You guys say, yeah, you know, these guys are right. Because they have a lot of wisdom, they're older. They know what they're talking about. Allah says, who is better? From one who says, I am believing Allah and makes da'wah for that cause. وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا مِمَّنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا وَقَالَ إِنَّنِي. Who's better? That's the best job. That's the best job. You know how you look at it? Who's better? A carpenter or a physician? Everyone with his right mind would tell you the physician. Not because of the education, but rather, this guy deals with wood. He may deal with your house. He may construct your house. It's a good, honorable job. But the physician deals with your body parts. He takes care of you. Which is more valuable? The body parts or the pieces of wood that are out there? You would say the body parts. You as a da'iyah deal with something better than both of those. The soul inside the heart. قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي. The Prophet brags. قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي. This is my path. What's your path, O Prophet? What are you bragging about? أَدْعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ. I make da'wah to Allah. Don't let your shortcomings stop you. Don't ever say, I've got my own problems. Will not fix this one and that one and the third one? Then I'll start talking about that. No, you're on the gate of Islam. If every one of you took Islam as though he's on the gate, he has to protect it, he has to spread it, he has to teach people about it, he has to represent it good. Then Islam would, wallah, I used to say, I used to calculate back in the days when I used to give a khutbah. I gave a khutbah once and I calculated. If every single Muslim in this country got 5 to become Muslim, we'd have all American Muslims. Is it hard? 5 who have no spiritual belief? Actually, you see them walking around as a, please, I want Islam. Their faces are telling you, they got no spiritual belief. Because when you don't have no spirit and belief in you, the Quran says you're an animal. What differs us from a pig and a cow? They eat, we eat. What differs us from them? Spirit and belief. Allah in the Quran describes them, أُولَٰئِكَ كَالْأَنْعَامِ. The ones without belief? He says, not even so. At least the animals know what they're here for.
Those without belief are worse. They, wallahi, in their eyes, are trying to tell you, come and take us. Come and rescue us. You as a Muslim are responsible for that. You as a Muslim are responsible from, because we don't want to see anyone in hellfire on the judgment day. That's why it's our responsibility to rescue them and find the path of da'wah for you in this life. I want to give you a story for those in most of us who say, you know, we have a lot of shortcomings, so we don't need to work for Islam now. Maybe it's a booster or encouragement to get us to work to Islam. It's about a companion who's considered the uncle of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas. He was heading to fight aggressors who are coming to attack Muslims. So he called, who's going to go to the outskirts to stop this invasion? And they gathered an army. The army had departed to the outskirts, and a man heard him. This is an authentic story. All my stories are reviewed for top authenticity. It's not fake and it's not weak. I don't bring no weak. And because alhamdulillah, we have in our books, our hadith books, a lot of stories that make us free from using all those weak hadith. So, a man who was unblessed with the sin of drinking. He was a drinker. He was a Sahabi radiallahu anhu, but he was a drinker. His name is Abu Mahjan al-Thaqafi. The army goes, he's drinking. You know what he does? He lets the army depart and goes, buys a jug of alcohol and follows the army. We gotta defend the Muslims? I have to go be with them. So he leaves the army to go in front, and he sits in the back and starts drinking. And they catch him. His imam tells him, you gotta go and help him. Yeah, he has a problem. That's a different issue. We deal with that and how we repent and how we start. But when Islam comes, I gotta be there for Islam. I can't let them go by themselves. So the army goes, they take him, they chain him, and they say, Sa'd, you know what this guy's doing? Because when Umar used to send Sa'd, he used to say, beware of your sins. That's what's gonna defeat him. They chain him up, the battle goes, and his punishment is a punishment we may not understand. His punishment, you can't fight. You tell me that, I would say, may Allah reward you, Sa'd. That's exactly what I wanted. I'm not going to go die. No. He begins to cry. Sa'd was sick. His wife Salma is there on a hilltop, the general, and he's there chained into one of these big metal poles. Sa'd is sick, and his horse is there, and he sits and weeps like a woman. They're fighting, and I'm sitting here with the sick and the woman. How could that happen? I would be there happy, watching them, seeing the kill. So he told Salma, sympathized with him, said, what's wrong, Abu Mahjan? He said, they're fighting like men, and I'm sitting here like a woman. Salma, could you do me a favor? Unleash that brace on my ankle, and I will go fight. If I die, you guys rest from me. You don't need me no more. And if I live, wallah, I'll come back and chain myself. Just let me go. She said, go ahead. She gave him al-Balqa, the horse of Sa'd, fast horse. And she gave him the sword of Sa'd, because Sa'd wasn't fighting. And Sa'd was in a tent being nursed. And he goes. The defeat was for the Muslims, because they came in a huge army. As soon as this guy goes, Sa'd gathers the strings and looks from the hilltop to the battlefield. He changed the defeat to a victory. Sa'd goes, you know that person far away over there? That's the swinging of Abu Mahjana, the guy he apprehended. You know that speed of that horse? That's my Balqa. Looks like my Balqa. Well, if they weren't tied up and chained back there, I would think that's them. He went and fought and changed it to a victory, because he was a strong fighter. He came back and changed himself. No, we're doing nothing. Look how beautiful that is. Look at the wisdom of that story. You know Imam Malik, one of the great four scholars, rahimahullah, one of the great four, he said, wallahi, I wish all my books were sent out and published and everyone got them without my name on them. Who cares if you're noticed or you're not noticed? Who cares if you go and spread a message on a fake name in the internet? And it's a good message. They may not know it, but Allah knows it. As long as Allah records it for you. He said, alhamdulillah, he did his mission. But Salma couldn't hold it in. The excitement. She said, Sa'd, you remember that guy you seen over there? That was Abu Mahjan. You remember the horse? I did give him the horse. He said, that was Abu Muhjana. He said, yes.
He went to Abu Muhjana. He said, I'm going to release the chain off your leg myself. Go.
Wallah will never whip you again for drinking.
Because that's a punishment in Islam.
He said, you guys are not going to punish me for drinking again?
Wallah, I'm not going to drink again.
I used to drink because you punish me every time. And Allah forgives the sin as a punishment.
The point of the story is, imagine how this man who had a problem,
it's not an easy sin.
It's among the top sins that we have in Islam.
But he didn't say, I got a problem, I can't serve Islam.
No, we got to work on that problem.
That's a totally different story.
But when it comes to Islam and when it comes to Dawah, Ramadan is coming up, and I know this university has a lot of activities during Ramadan. You got to participate. You got to help.
You know, there's an old famous quote by JFK.
I changed it a little bit.
Ask not what Islam can do for you. You ask what I can do for Islam.
Ask not what the MSA can do for you.
You go to the president and ask, what can I do?
How can I help? How can I participate?
We know, I'm not sure of the population of Muslims in this university, but if every one of us spread the word,
and you got everyone got two or three more brothers,
wallah, this is going to be one of the strongest khutbahs around.
And inshallah, they're going to be brothers participating.
Jazakumullah khair. And inshallah, we ask Allah, the Lord of the sky and the earth, to reward the people who started this.
We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He return it upon them in this life and in the life after.
Because when you give da'wah, when you do something for the sake of Allah, it doesn't come back for you just in the life after.
It's going to come back in this life.
You know, let me tell you a last story by Ibn al-Qayyim.
Not a story,
but he drew a distinction between something that happened with Yunus, with Ayub and Musa.
If you know the story of Ayub,
Ayub gave da'wah and got frustrated with his people.
So he got on a ship and he left.
He got sick of them.
Because sometimes, you know, people give you a hard time.
You got to pay. That's a totally, inshallah, different khutbah on being patient in da'wah.
They give you a lot of hard time. You're going to hear a lot of stuff.
That's why the Quran always talks about the stuff in the Quran about how being patient during da'wah.
So he just left his people.
He got on the ship. You know the story.
They said, we got to throw someone off the ship.
They threw him off the ship.
A whale swallowed him in. He remained in the whale for 40 years.
Musa, on the other hand, he didn't do nothing.
All he did was get away from people who were ousting him, who were bothering him, who were,
he had a right to do that.
But note, he stopped Da'wah.
He didn't do a crime.
He stopped Da'wah.
Look at Musa.
Musa, if you know his history, he killed.
He murdered.
He murdered someone from the people of Fir'aun.
He killed him.
Maybe not intentional, maybe he meant to hit him and he murdered.
A crime, something wrong.
Yunus didn't do that.
This one did something wrong.
What happened to Musa?
Musa continued in his da'wah.
He went to Fir'aun.
He stood against Fir'aun. He kept persisting against Fir'aun.
Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah says, look how Allah, what He did to a messenger who left da'wah, yet didn't do nothing wrong.
He got imprisoned in the stomach of a whale for 40 years.
The guy who did something wrong, but continued with da'wah, Allah protected him from the tyrant of his time,
and he continued on with his da'wah.
He said, that's how the effect comes back.
Something harmful is going to happen to you, but you did something for the sake of Allah.
That's how you should be. Take Islam to heart.
Take Islam as though it's your mother or your father.
Someone were to come and attack your mother and your father, you jump up and say, that's my mother and your father.
That's Islam. That's Islam you got to spread.
You know the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his daughter died.
You know, a caravan of hers, she was traveling from Mecca to Medina.
A caravan was attacked and she was wounded.
Later on in Medina, she died.
All his male sons died.
The only one who grew up to be months old, probably a year and a half according to history, was Ibrahim.
He loved him.
He used to brag about him, take him and say, my son Ibrahim.
He died a year and a half later.
His uncles, the ones who supported him, the non-Muslim ones who supported him,
and it, you know, was one of the hardest times of his life.
And his uncles, who were Muslim, Abu Talib and Hamza, died.
Khadija, the woman he loved more than anything in this life,
Khadija radiallahu anha,
the love of his life,
died.
You never ever hear in the Quran Allah sending him a condolence, telling him, be patient, don't worry about it.
Because he took it. He took it. He was patient. It didn't harm him that much. You know what harmed him? And almost what we would call today gave him a nervous breakdown? When he gives da'wah and people turn away from him. That's when the condolence comes in the Quran. لَعَلَّكَ بَاخِعُ النَّفْسَ Muhammad! Allah tells him, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you're destroying yourself. Take it easy. لَعَلَّكَ بَاخِعُ النَّفْسَكَ All you do is convey the message, but take it easy on yourself. فَعَلَّكَ بَاخِعُ النَّفْسَكَ عَلَىٰ أَثَارِهِمْ You're going after their traces. Seeking them and distraught over them just so they become believers. You, it's your duty, our duty to convey the outcome is up to Allah. Because the Prophet said on the judgment day, a messenger who comes and speaks to Allah through Jibril comes with one guy with him. One guy, one believer. He had tons of people, nations. One guy would come with him. And he says, يُؤْتَ الرَّأِ النَّبِيِّ وَمَعَهُ الرَّجُلَانِ وَيُؤْتَ النَّبِيِّ وَمَعَهُ And some of them come with three. And يُؤْتَ النَّبِيِّ And some of them come with a group. And then others would come with a larger like the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So make this a part of your da'wah and part of your life. You have to fit Islam into your skin. Don't tell me I'm too young. Mus'ab ibn Umayr, who established this Islam that we're all following, died a 21-year-old kid. 21. Your ages. Most of your ages. He went to Islam and built the foundation of the Islamic Khilafah in Medina. A young 21-year-old boy. Died 21. His life in Islam, in Islam was 18 to 21. Or 17. 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 4 years, his legacy lives on till the judgment day. Open nearly all the books that talk about the Sahaba. The men around the Prophet, the most famous book we all have, the first one is Mus'ab ibn Umayr. 21-year-old kid, why can't we all have the Mus'ab? We all have more education. Why can't we be the Tufayl ibn Amr al-Dawsi? It be start off by being for the sake of Allah sincere, not for people to talk. Well, it doesn't matter if they talk or they don't. Because on the judgment day, you're not going to bring your friends and you tell them, oh, you guys, remember I did this and that. It's between you and Allah. Wallah, it doesn't matter. And then give Islam time. Every one of you, alhamdulillah, the sisters and the brothers are well educated. They have means of da'wah. Give Islam part of your life. And as I said, this is inshallah gonna be, this is why I gave this khutbah in the start of this semester, because this is the start of the semester. We're expecting this MSA to hear a lot about it. Inshallah. Everyone's gonna participate. Bi-ithnillah ta'ala. Wallah, sometimes you hear, you know, I come here, I haven't been here actually 2 years, but you hear of activities and you hear of things that go on that make a heart melt. Young people, some stuff that are public and stuff that are not, activities, people who sacrifice not only their time, but wallahi of their wealth. May Allah reward them. ثم صلوا على خاتم النبيين وإمام المرسلين فقد أمركم الله بالصلاة والسلام عليه فقال إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما وقال صلى الله عليه وسلم من صلى علي واحدة صلى الله عليه بعشرة اللهم صل وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت وباركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد وارض اللهم عن الأربعة الخلفاء الأئمة الحنفاء أبي بكر الصديق وعمر الفاروق وذي النورين عثمان وأبي الصبطين علي وعن آل بيت نبيك الطيبين الطاهرين وعن أزواج أمهات المؤمنين وعن الصحابة والتابعين وعنا معهم بمنك وعفوك وإحسانك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم انصر الإسلام وعز المسلمين اللهم انصر الإسلام وعز المسلمين اللهم احفظ إخواننا المستضعفين في كل مكان اللهم أبرم لهذه الأمة أمر رشد يعز فيه أهل طاعتك ويذل فيه أهل معصيتك ويؤمر فيه بالمعروف وينهى فيه عن المنكر إنك يا ربنا سميع قريب مجيب الدعاء وأقم الصلاة